Seekers, runners, and gods of the time stream. Look to your left and admire the new bear named Buddy. Look to your right in horror at the dead of Chirai. Rest in peace, Blefanata. Grab your mugs, grab a friend, and join us to talk about all things the Dungeon Run. It's been so long since I've done that intro. Today we're keeping it short and sweet. Usually, for those of you who don't know, we have a couple of different segments that we do, but we have so much to talk about, so many opinions. We're going to be diving straight into the Amulets Council. And again, for those of you who don't know what that is, it's essentially where the Amulet summons a few different watchers of the time stream to join me and talk to me about the Dungeon Run. I'm hungry and hyper, so that's a thing. Joining me on the council today is the amazing Cam the Fog Pal. They are truly an amazing person and a younger sibling to me. They are one of the prominent artists, fan artists in this community. They have done amazing artwork, especially known for Vic, Siv and Lily with the Bardo, rest in peace. And so much more. And I believe they're still taking commissions to doing D&D art as well. So welcome, Cam.
That was a very nice intro. Thank you.
Thank you. I try, you know, sometimes. Also joining us on the council today is Kai Buck, one of the original members of the Dungeon Run community. And you can even may know him by his episodes without context, gifts and memes. But he does really well. So welcome, Kaiba.
Happy to be here. Thanks for having me.
Woo-woo. And last but not least, joining us for the first time on the Watch Party, you recent member, joined us not that long ago, but has been a very cringe and driving force for Team Force of Good. Everybody welcome, Hadrian X.
Hey, how are you?
Hello. I'm doing great. Thank you guys all for taking the time to join me and to express all of your passionate thoughts, feelings, and emotions about the Dungeon Run. Olsflotch has a lot of very passionate opinions, and I'm very excited for us to all share. The first thing we're going to talk about is the planning. It's been a hot topic on the Discord. It's been a hot topic for the cast and the community since we got here in Olsflotch. And I have a lot to say, but I thought that you guys could start first. Just thoughts on it, opinions on it, and where you think they're heading with it. Kai Buck, I know you really passionately spoke before we started recording first, so why don't you take it away?
You know what? The planning, I honestly really, personally, I really enjoyed the role play aspect of all the planning that went on.
He's referring to just the last episode, I think? Or you mean all of Olsflotch?
All of Olsflotch. All the planning. Wow. All the insanity that occurred. A three-way split, you know, I thoroughly enjoyed all of it because, I mean, people were doing a lot with being given very little. I mean, there was one person who did a heist all their own while shackled, no access to any magic, and not just shackled behind their back, which I think is also the greatest example of intelligence versus wisdom, because while the most intelligent person in the party, it took somebody with more wisdom to figure out why not just bring your hands around and step through.
Okay, so what I'm hearing from you also is you really enjoyed the episodes as a whole and the planning.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Like, fantastic. All the planning, everything, all the way to the sendings back and forth, trying to communicate, trying to figure out what was going on with people all over the place. And the sending between James and Siv was one of my favorite parts of the entire thing.
And why?
Honestly, it was just, the most part was Siv's response. You know, Siv kept his response very short, very in the moment, very business. And when he said Sivrak reborn, mm-hmm. That pretty much told me Civ was done playing around. And that carried through into the next stage of it, all the way trying to get to the Achairai. I mean, Civ is done playing around. He's ready. Uh-huh. It's go time.
Interesting. Okay. I love how, by the way, real quick, when he was like, I'm sorry, what did you say? That was hilarious. We just missed the sending all entirely. That's something I would do.
They do get great coverage in Ayn, by the way.
It's
I wish I could get that at my house.
5G all the way.
Yeah,
5G. Hadrian, your comments on the planning aspect of...
Reacting to what Kaibuk said, most of the things he named actually have nothing to do with planning. They were all role-play things. So it's not actually the planning. It's the role-play and the decision-making that's good. And yeah, I was a big fan of, despite how it got there, the whole plot line of going back to the Ashen Mage's lair. A lot of that was like really bold choices that were made in the moment when given really bad roles. Like if just her intimidation check had gone different, we would be in a whole different place. We'd be on like episode 3 of the liberation of Old Svach instead of fleeing in terror. But none of that was planned. And at a certain point, some of the planning will get to where it feels like it's going circular, and it's just kind of like, well, if you don't want to have a plan, just don't have a plan. Just say you're going to wing it and just go for it. And I guess we could talk about more, but yeah, it's also interesting how much the sort of game mechanics of the dungeon run versus just regular D&D play into that too.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Cam, I know it's dangerous. Open thoughts on plot planning.
I have many thoughts on the way they plan things. If we're talking about the whole Allspad situation, I feel like during the first part about planning the heist, we got to see that thing about costumes and names like to the maximum. And I hope that this heist was a lesson for them to like actually focus on the things, on plans that make them work. And I think some of the characters actually learn from that, because during that whole episode where we had planning, it wasn't as much planning as trying to... I think the reason why it lasted a whole episode was because they weren't sure what they were trying to accomplish, so that's why planning was hard. But you got a few characters like mostly I think it was Lily and Ago saying, okay, but we don't need to go too complicated with this. We don't need to add extra elements. We just need to find the things we want to do, like set a goal and try to do that and do it fast. And I think that's the way they planned during that last episode is a bit closer to what I don't want to say they should do, because they can do whatever they want, but to a most effective way of planning. So I hope that the way they all went completely off the rails before, I feel like it's going to teach them to plan better. And I feel like they are already improving on that aspect.
No. As long as they keep the name strategies, because Juicy was the greatest name they've ever come up with.
I love it. Okay. My turn. Okay. So I want to start off by saying in this last episode, 83, I know my stuff. In 83, I agree. You could tell, and we will dive a little more into it, as Cam said, they were starting to finally say, this no planning thing might not work. Hey, our style of planning may not be effective. And you can see very clearly throughout the whole episode, even though they did spend the majority of it planning, you could see them changing or trying a new tactic, even with each other, how to respond. You could see it, and I loved it. I loved every second of that episode. It was awesome. But the key word for me is finally. What I think, and I was telling these guys backstage that I was so passionate when Ron and Jeff were on the cooldown this last week when, you know, I understand that it was very skillful and I understand the episode was amazing. It was. My point is, I love that they're finally here, but when the party fails, when the party misses out on information, we miss out on information. We fail. When they feel stressed, we feel stressed. I think it's valid to be frustrated that it took them over 80 episodes to start saying, hey, this isn't going to work out. 80 episodes. I'm glad it's here, but I just, it's a long time coming. Okay? I have a lot of emotions.
We know, it's okay.
I love the way Grimfaded worded this section when she commented her thoughts on the Discord when she was saying she's getting really frustrated that they focus on breadcrumbs. And it's so true because they get so stuck on, I need to do this one thing. And that could be why their planning also isn't that great. They really are not great at looking at the bigger picture. And what I mean by that is if their goal was to save Ulswatch, which in my thoughts, two or three episodes ago, that's what they decided to do. They were going to help Lostrana. They were going to, you know, free them from the oppressors. Oh no, they're in town beating people up. We're going to fix that. That was their mentality. Their idea was to send the illusion across the wall saying they left. Fantastic. Why did they feel the need to add the message at the end? Here's a Bingler going to come back and save Lostrana. Wasn't your plan to separate yourselves from the town? Why did you just connect? You literally just linked the two of you guys. And if your goal is to put them less on guard, why would you want to tell them you're coming back? I know Ugo said it was for hope, but again, this is kind of the, where is your head at? I mean, not trying to be mean, but I think the heroes of Bingle are a little too big for their pants. Who says you're gonna come and save these people? False hope is just as dangerous as having no hope at all, I think.
Well, and it's full confirmation to the guards and the vetch and everybody else. This is who we are. You're putting yourself on blast.
Literally, for no reason. Yeah. In my opinion. I mean, do the other two of you agree as well? Like, again, Ugo was like, give them hope, we're the heroes. And I didn't see it that way. I just was like, you're literally defeating the point that you're trying to do. I didn't understand it.
I didn't think about it from the, like, you're defending the point. I didn't even make that connection, but I think they are definitely, like, promising more than they can do, because Ulswatch is not, like, the other city with the dog. I don't remember the name. It's not, like, there's one problem that they can go and in 3 days solve.
Ulswatch,
Wingbird, that one.
Wingbird, yep.
Ulswatch has been like this for a really long time, and even like Jeff was talking about how the geography like formed the differences between the Highstrana and Lostrana. So this is not something that five people can come in, and it's like, I'm going to say to all people around the world in real life, like, I'm going to end all wars and hunger, and that's not going to happen. I don't have the power to do that, and I don't think they have the power to dismantle this whole system. And that's also when at first I was like, yeah, get the bone, help the people. And then I was like, but if you get the bone and the, like, turn the cheesemonger to the veg, and they find out that he is someone from Lostrana who was using bad, evil magic means to get on top, wouldn't they make them hate Lostrana even more and be more harsh to the people down there? And I don't think there's an easy way of solving what's happening to the town, and I honestly don't think it's something they can do. Like, they can maybe start eventually, they make enough like political connections across the world of pain, start dealing with that, but
They just take a side pause on the journey and get into politics.
I mean, this is not a campaign that focuses heavily on politics, so I don't really see them doing that.
That's so, for level 15.
We'll get there. Yeah, we'll get there. Yeah.
I'm picturing it as like the tweet summary is Heroes of Bingol will come back to save you, Lostrana. Lostrana response, who?
Yes.
Like,
yes.
You give them hope. Who are you? You've been here 2 days.
Gorvin Plains.
Bingol, I've never even left this place. But
yeah. What Heroes of Bingol?
Well, okay, and it's not just that, but we'll be back. Oh, we forgot our birds. Bye.
Yeah. Exactly. And they put them at more risk for their birds. And it's like, where is your guys' actual goals? And Hadrian, just to point out, Gorbin played, shout out to you, Kurt, who's going to do the editing of this video. He was like, you're so lucky I'm not on there, because he wanted to make that point of like, they're going to be like, who are you people?
Although they not only got the birds, they also got a bear and a horse.
Mm-hmm.
Did they get the horse?
A horse thing.
Wait for the horse.
The horse, of course.
Section.
Controversial. Yeah.
No. Exactly. They've heard. It wasn't even James's voice that said they're. Yeah. So they don't even recognize. I was going to say they've heard James's voice once.
Look, they got out of there with the bare necessities.
Backstage we were talking about the plot holes of Ulsbach and how you sort of failed his check on the horse, and you guys shouldn't have a horse, but you take your horse of many colors. You guys will need it. You'll need it.
But also, how great is it that we all watch a show that has a controversial horse in it?
Got it. Yeah. We should name the horse something very controversial too. but yeah, I think that's just, I really think, not even just planning wise, the heroes, I don't like to call them the heroes just yet, the party, they need to decide, what is our goal? What do we want? Because they can't keep saying, we're going to save this city, that's our focus. That's fine. Don't put your own interests first and then backtrack. And then, I mean, they literally left Lostrana worse off than even when they agreed to save Lostrana. Because again, what's going to stop them from all going back there? They now have stolen horses, they're dead. I mean, they're just going to go attack the place again. And some heroes. But yeah, they need to decide. Is their goal to save individuals? Is their goal to stop the Ashen Mage? Where do you guys, you just have my take, where do you guys think that they do that? That they think that they can do more than they really can? Where do you guys think? Asking the tough questions on the
watch. This is the tough question.
Each other. No, I agree. I think they try to do more than they can. And I think they should, like you were saying, what's their goal? Saving individuals or the Ashen Mage? They definitely can do both. I say can't. I pronounced it like wrong. Well, and I feel like maybe they even have, as scary as the Ashen Mage is, they even have more chances of trying to like succeed if they focus, like they commit to one thing, even if that's just her. Because, I mean, killing one person that's super powerful or dismantling the whole politics and socioeconomic system of a city, which one is like easier for these adventurers to do? I definitely agree that they need to focus to be able to do anything, really. I don't know what, if they ever choose, what will they choose?
I think we have the benefit of being on the outside looking in versus the positions that they're in, so it's very easy for us to critique. But I think
and we
that,
will. I'm just kidding.
Oh yeah, of course. That's what we're here for. We're here to critique. But I think that the ultimate goal, the ultimate mission is saving or freeing the wardens and defeating the Ashen Mage. That I think everybody and the heroes of Bingol, everybody knows that is the ultimate goal. Then they need to break it down by smaller goals instead of just lurching straight into, we are going to save Lostrana. Okay, so you have a built-in minor support system with the vermin. How do we grow that minor support system? After you grow that minor support system, what's the next stage? What, and the stage after that, then ultimately, how do you defeat the vetch?
You know, you're getting Mike over here on a big whiteboard. Okay, team, listen. You just break it down.
Swap. But, I need to...
look, here is something that they did a long time ago and they need to bring back. It's Lily's to-do list.
Mm.
They haven't done it in a long time. When they had it, it did very well.
I don't know if I would agree with very well, but if it gets them in the right direction, let's go. Hashtag team leave Oswatch. All of us.
Well, yeah.
In unison we stand.
I'm even at the extreme of like, I have the whole time that they've been talking about doing all this other stuff been like, you came here to do a funeral. Like, why are you doing all this other stuff?
Yeah.
And I guess we kind of got at it of like them figuring out what their purpose is and their decision making. But, you know, it's kind of a problem in RPGs in general of like, where do side quests fit? Like when you have a complete open sandbox like this, you know, it does become hard to prioritize. Like, I mean, it was episode 12 when they decided not to go get, or not to go to Thorn the first time. And that was a big crossroads that they had to make a decision. But, you know, it makes me also think of, you know, where do the side quests come in of, you know, it always feels ridiculous in a video game that's like this, where you're, you know, the dragons are being reborn and burning the town, but I've got 15 bear pelts that I've got to get to this one trapper over in this village. And I really wanted to finish that quest out. That's the extreme example, but you know, I think what it is here is, yeah, they saw some breadcrumbs of the Ashen Mage, but they don't have an overall strategy of what they're doing about the Ashen Mage.
I agree. I will say for me, I was totally hashtag team heist originally. Like when it came to that side quest, I was like, I'm in. But as soon as they failed it, again, focus. I think they just take things too far. I know Kurt is going to have so much fun editing this video because we are going totally back and forth, so that's okay. Now I want your guys' quick opinions on how you felt the characters either were starting to grow or change in that second planning. Because I have thoughts, but I want to hear from you guys. Kyblek, you said you enjoyed it all the way through and you could see them making an effort. What did you notice? What stood out to you the most about it?
Gosh, you know, honestly, the interactions that they had together in and out of combat, you know, when Civ ran around the corner trying to draw them in and he had that interaction with Uggo, well, you can go in if you really want. Well, fine with me! And he goes charging in. You know, it's very in character for Uggo. But at the same time, as Uggo's kind of progressing along this paladin path, he's starting to become more reserved at the same time. So I'm really enjoying watching that development between them. Civ, you know, Sivirak Reborn, you know, seeing him get down to business. I mean, there was no mercy with Civ. James trying to control the environment around him and what was in the environment. Fahima using her bonds with the animals and everything. Lily with her psychological warfare. You know, I mean, I love every aspect of it. And in the pure chaos that ensues, Jeff just rolling with the punches. Mm-hmm. You know, Jeff has a very unique ability to just, okay, this is pure chaos. Let's roll with it. You know, he doesn't try to reel them in. He lets them go because it's organic.
I agree. I think the organicness and genuineness of the show is not comparable to other shows. It's amazing. It's one of the things that attracted me most to the show. Mm-hmm. Hadrian, you seem to react a little bit there.
Well, part of my reaction, I think some of it's you talking about Jeff at the end. The other thing that struck me about this battle was that, like, it felt like the first battle where, like, not to get too like game mechanic-y, but like the challenge rating actually matched where they are for the first time in a long time. Like the fact that you basically had Uggo and Civ in like full damage machine mode, and it still took them
time
3 or 4 rounds to get through that door. And I mean, I know they tied all the bad guys up there for the most part, and that sort of let the rest of the party have free reign. But you know, if this was, you know, a sort of typical epic epic fantasy, like they would have taken 3 seconds to get through. You know, that would have been a round of combat, and the heroes would have just charged in. And the fact that it was like guards too that are now. Which, I mean, it had been established that the guards at the house had, you know, pretty high-level spells, which is part of the the beginning of the end of everything in Allsvatch. So, you know, it fits with that, but, you know, I think some of it is, you know, them getting to internalize, like, you know, you just don't get to advantage and force a good card your way through every single battle anymore.
I agree. And there were some people in chat, I don't know if it was in chat or direct messages, but people did message me like, wow, the guards actually have like a lot of life. Like they're not just hacking through them. It's taking
time. Yeah, I think we tried to calculate and it was like one of them had 60 some hit points.
Yeah. I biased, but I mean, maybe not biased. I agree. I think that they really did learn the hard way that Allsvatch was no joke. And they couldn't just walk in. I think even maybe they didn't, but that wasn't as smooth as I thought they think it was going to go. And they had some challenges, and it was great. Cam?
I was trying to put my thoughts about this battle in order. This might sound a bit mean, but I started enjoying the battle a bit more as soon as Jeff started reminding them that the birds were getting attacked and were probably going to die. And I really liked, like similar to what Kaibok said, the role that each member of the party like took. Sip was not like only like, okay, I'm going to do what has to be done. He was like, that was not only about the birds. That was him never getting to do anything back against the guards that always tortured him, and he was taking this opportunity to take it off on them. And well, Uggo didn't damage as a way of protecting as usual, but also I feel like the way that Lily and Fahim approach it, like trying to not be noticed until the last second, was great and had a lot to do with the fact that they were just like captured in a bad situation like 2 episodes ago. And the part that I liked the most was that, yeah, they didn't specifically like plan what they were going to do, but each of them found like a role to fulfill, like trying to distract, trying to get the birds, trying to attack people. And I really like that James was the one to go directly to the birds, because we know he never had a great relationship with them. But he even said at the end of the episode that he has these like awful powers, and he needs to do good with them. And he wasn't able to convince them to get the bone, so he needed to do something good. And then something good in this situation was not like attacking the guards, it was saving the bird. And that's why I think he was like so forward to doing that. And I really like that, and thinking about that.
It's fun how you kind of, all three of you, because I sometimes need to slow down with my thoughts. I love how you could see you could see the difference, like they're planning or they're trying to grow, how it really did play into the battle. Sivrak is done, but I agree, it was so much more personal. That was not just about birds. I mean, spitting in their faces. I mean, he lost it. But it was coming from a very personal, pent up. I would even argue a little bit that it was also fueling from my take, the party was not listening to him either. The entire time he was like, we should do this. And they were like, this was him just being like, it's my turn. Whether it be the best way to handle it or not, he finally got to just do. And he just, he let it all out. He really did. James, Hadrian and I talked a little bit about this the other day. James is, I know Siv is internally struggling outward, but James is, he's, I feel he's pretty high in emotions, just he's internalizing it. He's not being as open as Siv is, but I think James is really struggling right now. I think, and my perspective, you can really see that, which again, shout out to the organic and genuineness of them just playing their characters. You could see James throughout the last few episodes. He was all like, no, let's just go in and get the bone. You know, he's, James is being much more impulsive than he normally is. Mr. Calculate over here, Mr. Let's weigh our odds, is now like, I don't care what the bone does. It's going to help. We need, it's almost as if he's trying to justify it, because I know he's regretful for what he's done. Again, maybe he's not handling it the best either, but I think he's so remorseful about what he's done to this town and the fact that he knows his powers aren't good. He's just so desperate to actually help at this point that it's like, I need instant gratification, right? I need instant help. I need to do something now. And it clearly isn't the best way. Hashtag team leave old Spotch, but it's genuinely him trying. It's him like... Sincerely, I think he's struggling with himself. I think he's struggling with his self-worth. I think he's struggling with his choices. And as Siv is killing himself on the outside, I think Morgan is, or James is, like, internally at the end of his rope. I really do. And I think it really shows very well. And I think someone needs to take care of James' emotions just as much.
Yeah, actually, yeah. Hashtag team emotional transparency, too.
Yeah.
Is really what that's about.
I also want to backtrack a little bit on Sivrak's mental breakdown. There's one thing to me that I didn't quite understand, and I'm hoping you guys can enlighten me. Yes, for the record, this was before the cooldown, so if Jared was on the cooldown and explained all this, great. I thought that his breakdown in some parts didn't necessarily make sense to me. And this is also a hot take, which surprised me that everybody was all on board with it. Siv has lost his mind. In the chat, everyone was like, Siv, we understand and we're here for you. And I'm sitting here like, this guy's losing his marbles. What are you talking? Don't praise him for brutally murdering people. My hot take is I think this was comparable to the Sea Hag in terms of the majority of the party just letting loose. They don't care. Again, Siv and Ugo didn't just kill or incapacitate these guards. They were brutally murdered. And again, if you want to get into the politics of Ulzvach, to some degree, I really thought that Vlad and their whole experience with Vlad was going to kind of humanize the guards. Not saying the guards are perfect, not saying they haven't done their fair share, but as, again, I hope the party is learning, we all make mistakes, and we're all human. We all have a reason for doing what we're doing. In their city, it's be the one punching the Lostrana or be in Lostrana, right? I mean, to some degree, who said these guards weren't just like Vlad doing what they had to do? They were told to go kill birds. I mean, and I'm an animal lover, but not all the people care about birds. Like, why was that such a you must die and be murdered scenario, I feel? There was very much a backwards turn for them. I mean, the spitting and the utter violence. And then Siv threatened to kill a little boy. Everyone else was cool with that? Everyone else was cool with child murder? Cool? And everybody was like, good job, Siv. Don't get me wrong. I love the character arc, but I mean, can we not talk about how alarming that is?
It really is. And as you said, this, you said, like, well, they were birds, was like this really needed to happen. And it's what I said earlier, it's not about birds, it's about Siv not being a little child anymore and being able to fight back and do to the guards the things that they did to a lot of people he knew probably before, in my opinion.
100%.
And I mean, it may, I don't think it's okay. I think the party should be like really worried about Sid and not let him walk away, like sit him down and talk for once. But the whole thing with the guards made sense, but I was like super worried when he started threatening the kid, like for real. That was like a bit confusing for me.
Okay, so I wasn't the only one. And I think what confused me more is, I think 5-ish hours earlier in the story, 1 week prior in real life, an older man of Lostrana saw him, right? He was like, "You're the ones that they're looking for." All Sid did was hush and throw him money. How did he go from there to, "I will now murder and cut off this kid's tongue because he saw us"? I was just like, what?
And even if you remember earlier on the campaign, Sid was like super good to kids. He always gave them money. And on the Dwarven City, he was like performing tricks for them. And
yes.
When we get to Allswatch and he starts threatening the kid, that it's not even like a rich kid, he works on the stables.
Yeah, 100%. And that's what, where my confusion, I get his break, I get it's personal, but I agree. Even when he was in Lostrana, even like with Kirsta, they always talked about, "We have to protect the kids, we got to do this for the kids." He's always been for the kids of Lostrana. Why does he want to torture and murder one? I genuinely, even though I get the psych break, I didn't understand that. I didn't understand why he was just so ready to murder a kid. I don't get it.
Well, with Siv, and I think Jared has done a great job portraying this in the past, you know, Siv has PTSD. And he was in a situation loaded with every trigger that Siv has experienced. So yeah. Siv didn't just have a mental break. I mean, it was a shatter. I mean, that was, you know, his psyche was shattered in that. So Siv went to a very dark place, and I can kind of understand it because he wasn't thinking like normal Siv. I mean, I get, yeah, I know, shocker, right? I mean, he seems so free in poetry writing, but yeah. But yeah, I mean, I think that might be something that might have been missed in his kind of break there. Like I said, I feel like it was more of a mental shatter than a mental break.
And if you're right, then that kind of shows Cam and my point more, and the party needs to do something. And here's my other last passionate spiel when it comes to their planning. And this is just a me thing, so if you guys disagree, let me know. I know, I have emotions. The party never is a strong word. The party hardly ever holds each other accountable. They don't. Why was no one in that room? And I get it, mental break. But to be fair, Siv has said this entire 80 whatever episodes that what has kept him going towards the good side, what even helped him want to be a better person, was his party, Lily and the party. So why are the party not like, this is just a random example, not that they had to do this, but why is the party not standing their ground? Why did Lily not say, "If you want to kill this kid, you have to kill me too"? Because you know he would have backed off right away. There's no way he would even entertain the idea, break or not. And but I feel that way about all of them. They don't really hold each other accountable for their mistakes. They don't really say, "That wasn't a great idea, let's move on," or like, "Hey, I noticed that was not cool." They don't hold each other accountable. They kind of just over validate each other, and they're just like, "Everything's fine," and it's not. It's not okay.
Well, not yet. I mean, my reaction to Sivrak was, and I thought, you know, as Kaipuk said earlier, like, just including that in that message said so much in just, what, 2-3 words? And that, you know, so much of what happened last episode was he's just in a complete regression. Partially because of what's gone in the city and being back in a place that he said he never wanted to return to. But also, I saw him reacting to a lot of, you know, a lot of how he was acting was a reaction to how the party had been treating him. To the extent they had a plan before they went to Allswatch, it was, "We're going to do whatever Siv says." Number of things that they have done that Siv said to do is maybe a half. And then even when he walked in to that fight, I mean, my mind went back to, I think it's the Stranger's Fate episode where Ugo was like, you just sit in the shadows and attack while I'm out there taking like 80% of my hit points to keep all the rest of you safe. And Civ was the first one that marched into that fight. He fought, you know, he still used his rogue abilities, but he still, he fought a lot more open than he would have 40 odd episodes ago. So you know, in my mind, that was part of that arc. And part of that, him going so extreme at the end was also just, you people aren't going to listen to me. You know, I'm going to see where the line is with you.
Okay, that's fair.
And, you know, I guess the rest of the party also wasn't prepared for that, which...
So you agree with me ultimately, because I thought that too. I was like, I think also this is Austin's party, his frustration with the party, because he's not going to talk to them about it. Because again, they don't really hold each other accountable for whatever reason, communication. But I agree. He was, I mean, yes, I know he blames himself. He confirmed in the last episode he feels that everything that's happened is his fault. However, whether Civ Brack thinks this or not, if the party would have listened to him at any point in time in being in Ulsplach, it would have gone so much better. All he asked to do was, let's not make a scene. And I'm all they did in Ulsplach was make a scene.
They literally got, like, the war sirens going that haven't been used in 20 years.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I
mean, yeah.
Even from the very
That's
start.
Not Loki. Like,
yeah.
Exactly.
Well, I mean, to be fair, to your point, like, holding people accountable, there has been more than one occasion where Ugo has tried to vent his frustrations about things being unnecessary, trying to hold people accountable. But he has still, like, fought and voiced his opinions about things being necessary or unnecessary to hold people accountable. And often he gets shot down. And he gets ignored. And I have a feeling in the coming episode that Ugo is going to speak his mind again on that.
Well, I was going to say, they didn't listen to Civ at all in Ulsplach. You see how Ugo reacts when you don't listen to him and Thorne, because I agree, he's not going to let that slide. Nope. He's not going to be the quiet one. I just feel as a group, they aren't really, this isn't good, let's not do that. They don't do that with each other. They even the sea package situation, when Lily attempted once in this campaign to truly hold them accountable for their morality, they argued with her. They argued. Ugo and Fahima were like, "You're wrong, Lily." Like, they don't do well at really meshing as far as. And I think also, they may not know what their beliefs are. Maybe that's what the issue is. Can't really hold someone accountable if you don't know what you're doing yourself.
So you think they need to come up with a mission statement? Is that?
I do. Okay, look, let's go back to your whiteboard. We'll
yeah, spot it out.
Overall, I think James and Sivrak are emotionally at their highest, and they need help, like yesterday. I think that someone needs to really remind them or console them, because they both feel like they're failing. They're showing it in very different ways, and they need help to guide them back onto even be able to focus. I think Lily is doing a better job at... being present, and I want to give Katie and Lily a shout out in terms of Lily's defense mechanism is pretending everything is fine all the time. You're fine. My favorite example of that is when Sim was like, "Lily, I'm a killer," and she's like, "I don't see you that way." It's like, this man, exactly, this man murders people.
I'm murdering this guy.
Exactly.
I'm a murderer.
That's my favorite. Exactly. That's my favorite example. She was like, "I just don't see it." And he's sitting here, just murdered the CIA. This was right after that when she made that comment, and it's like, her defense mechanism is, this world is like bingo. And I think that planning episode in this episode, she's finally, in my eyes, waking up. She's like, "I can't think everything's okay all the time." And she did a really good job at saying, "Guys, let's assume the worst. Guys, let's be careful." She was much more serious in demeanor. She was much more reality of the situation. She backtracked a little bit in this last episode, where she was like, "I'm not going to let Civ kill you." And then in the same conversation said, please go home and don't say anything so we don't have to cut out your tongue? I was like, you know, if you threaten them nicely, it's still a threat, just so you know. But, I mean, I give her credit and she's trying to be more present. And I stand for it. It's hard for Lily to hold the party accountable if she thinks everything's perfect. And then I think Fahima really showed growth and she was trying to be less impulsive. Kind of what you guys said about the battle. She was trying to stick with her strengths. She was trying to not just run in, which is so not Fahima's usual MO. She stayed low key. She waited till her moment. That's
how fire in a barn. Yeah, it's improvement.
They're getting
there. She literally said, this, if we run in, this is going to be the thing that happened with Meep, like, yesterday, yeah, all over again. So she's actually, like, learning from that.
Yes, and I can see that. And how hard it must be to be an impulsive person and to really reel yourself back. The fact that Fahima was not like, let's get the bone, in general, I was like, she's scared, and she should be. And she's really contemplating her actions. I'm glad she took that way versus, I just successfully did a heist on my own. Let's do this. You know, instead of being cocky about it, she was like, I still think we should tone it back, which I think is great.
Yeah.
Any final closing thoughts, predictions, or what you're excited for in the next episode? Oh, Hadrian, I'll make you go first.
I mean, I'm definitely excited to be out of Olsvach. My blood pressure went down about 20 points as soon as they cleared that teleportation circle. I'm glad that we didn't decide to try and complicate the mechanics around that. But yeah, I'm looking forward to seeing a different setting. I feel like part of what's been going on the last few episodes is like, they wandered into the part of the sandbox that's like level 27 when they're level 9 and, you know, haven't necessarily known how to deal with that. And hopefully now we're getting pointed back towards the area of the map that we're supposed to be in. And I know it's not, you know, that's video gamifying it, but,
you can tell you're such a video game, like,
mindset. Yeah, well, sorry, that's what I thought.
I love it. It's fine.
No, it would be good to see some growth and, you know, maybe level 10 is, you know, supposed to be the next tier of the campaign.
Cam?
I'm sure they will be on a more manageable area when they get to the orcs. I mean, I completely agree.
100%. Yeah, they're no, it's gonna be calm. It's going to be peaceful.
I think I'm really looking forward to is them actually like communicating about what happened. Mostly I'm really interested in seeing what happens with Siv, because I absolutely love the conversation he had with his friend when he got the dead thistle, because I have many thoughts about that.
You didn't share any of them.
Yeah, I don't know if I said it before when I was in the last council, but I love that Siv is being faced. I mean, I feel bad for the character sometimes, but I love that he is being faced with things from his past, because I feel like he can't really move on if he just tries to shut down everything he used to be. I feel like he has to recognize that this happened and find ways to deal with it, like actually deal with it, not bury it and I'm going to walk away and sleep on a tree kind of way. So that's one of the main reasons why, as an example, I would love for him to keep his Sivrak accent, also that accent, because I feel like Siv will only truly be Siv when he stops trying to be a fake version of himself and he reconciles the two lives he's lived. So that's why I'm looking forward to seeing how this plays.
It's beautiful. Wait, what Curso said, the solution isn't to forget, it's to remember who you are. Beautiful.
Because one last thing, and sorry, because if you try to just forget as soon as you're faced with things from your past, it's all going to come back.
It can't really
learn
go
how
away.
To deal. Yeah, if you learn how to deal with that, you can truly remain yourself on your those situations. No gay book.
Hashtag goals for Sif. I love it.
Yeah. Honestly, with the next episode coming up, I mean, I think we all know that there's a travel montage coming, but we just need that theme music for the travel montage. I'll add that on the whiteboard. I really am looking forward to a very emotional episode, and I think that is coming. There's a lot of things that happen, a lot of very emotional things that happen. You know, so I'm anticipating it. I'm hoping for it. I'm looking forward to it. Seeing a lot of things kind of come to a head. I think we're kind of at that point with the party. So I think that is something that we're going to see, and I'm looking forward to it. I'm hoping for it.
Can I go again?
Sorry. Yeah.
You go
ahead.
First, and then I'll go.
No, you go again. You're wonderful. Go.
Okay. I think the thing I'm looking forward to most coming up is seeing how, you know, consequences are real consequences are starting to get introduced. Sadly, it was with the pets more than any of the players. Not that I wanted to see anything bad happen to any of the PCs.
And Diptha,
yeah. You know, Jeff is clearly, as I said in the battle part, like he's cranking up the sort of stakes and seeing what that does to how they play and how they move forward.
And while all this is going on, my mind keeps flashing to Jorl, putting another mark on the wall for how many days he's been in jail. Because it's been a year and a half he's been in jail.
Yes, he did say he was fine, to be fair. But
he's always fine.
He's
having a great day.
So that's Vlad. Vlad's the one having a great day. I am so on hashtag save Torvald before hashtag save Jorl. Not that Jorl doesn't need saving, but this poor man has been helping the party, and he's been in trouble too. And it is about time that hashtag Torvald the unappreciated gets some attention. I voted to save Torvald every single time, and clearly I lost. But it's about dang time that Torvald, you know, hopefully he's alive by the time we get there. I don't think we're going to get to them this episode. I'm really excited to see how the party talks, because I agree. This will be a talking, maybe a random encounter battle episode, but they're talking. There's no way they just march straight to Thora. They are going to hash their feelings out, and I'm very excited to see how it goes. I'm also really excited to get to Torvald whenever we get there. Ugh, long time coming. And you know what else I'm excited for? I'm excited for Whitebeard's stat block to be put on the Patreon, because that's what we all really want to see around here. That's what I'm looking forward to. Hadrian, do you want to go again?
Well, I had one other thing on Cam's comments about Civ is... It made me think of all the discussion around the Winter Soldier versus the White Wolf around Captain America and the Winter Soldier, which I don't know if you guys followed that. So, but it's kind of the same. It's the same. Like he's, you know, he started out as kind of a happy-go-lucky little soldier boy, and then became a terrible assassin for 80 years, and then you know had an arc where he tried to redeem himself, and then the end of the show sort of showed him trying to bring all parts of those together without necessarily just forgetting about them. But
he plays it beautifully. JRK Jack, your ability to really go into deep emotions is amazing. Shout out to JRK Jack, everybody.
Yeah.
No? Okay.
What
tough
is it crowd. Say? Oh, that was a cheer. Sorry.
That was. It was, you know.
Also, because no one else said it, whenever we get there, I'm also excited about getting to learn more about Ava's human mom. That's something that's apparently coming, and it's going to be really interesting. I think a lot of things about Ava's past are kind of blurry and hard to place on a timeline. And maybe this can help a bit with that.
Good point. And closing thoughts for sure. In fact, Ugo even said in the last episode, let's not go to Thorne. Let's sidetrack and get to Thorne through Human Mama. He did say that. Finally, yes, I think Ugo's backstory is a long time coming. And because I know a little bit of Ron's thought process, because he plays it so smoothly, it's confusing on purpose. And I'm so excited for him to kind of clear it up. Yeah, and he's done it so well. I know he's thought out Ugo's story very thoroughly, and it's really important to him, and it shows. And I'm so excited to learn more about Human Mama for sure. It's one of the bigger mysteries of the Iron Campaign. I don't think we're going to get to Human Mama next episode either.
Sometime in the future.
Yeah, I'm definitely looking forward to it. So overall, thank you guys for joining us. Thank you guys for joining me. Thank you guys for... hashing out our emotions. Stay tuned for the cool down that you're gonna already see after this anyway, but excited to see all of you guys on Wednesday. I'm excited for Whitebeard's stat block. That's not a hint or anything, and we'll see you guys on the live show. Don't forget, humankind
Be bold.